Hey, it's Seraphine, and I'm going to show you how to get the perfect ear on your artisan bread. Here are my credentials for making this video. As you can see, I think my sourdough bread rocks a pretty awesome mohawk, and I can tell you exactly how I got it, including one very underrated factor that can be absolutely crucial to getting a good ear, and is the reason a lot of breads look like this instead of this. So let's jump right in and find out how we can actually get a fantastic ear on the bread. We're going to go through this chronologically, following the bread baking process, starting with the first two things you absolutely need to make sure of with your dough, which are the gas production and gas retention. These are what really boost the bread up in the oven, and if you don't have these two things, then you're basically making a form of porridge. In bread dough, gas production is done by our leavening agent, and that is typically baker's yeast in its many variants, or the more natural sourdough starter. In this aspect, sourdough can be more challenging than baker's yeast to work with because it's made from wild microorganisms and therefore has a certain layer of unpredictability. That's why it's very important to make sure your sourdough starter is mature and rises on a predictable schedule. This will pretty much ensure that the starter is free from most harmful bacteria and microbes and is capable of being made into a strong levain that can then power the gas production in the dough. With instant yeast, you can pretty much follow the general guidelines of roughly allowing the dough to double in size during bulk fermentation and proofing. Although not always entirely accurate, they will typically work for bread dough, and this leads to the second thing you need to make sure your bread dough can do if you want it to get an ear. It needs to be able to retain gas. For bread made with wheat flour, we are talking about the gluten and gluten development here. The windowpane test is the gold standard for testing the dough. When you stretch the dough out that thinly, you're testing its ability to remain together when being stretched out by the gas produced. That's why the dough has to pass the test at the end of its gluten development. With straight doughs that are mixed to full development right at the start, usually made with instant yeast and a stand mixer, you test the dough right after mixing. For doughs that are developed with no-knead methods, such as stretch and fold, I generally test the dough after the last stretch and fold. You could also test it after bulk fermentation, and if it doesn't pass, then you could pre-shape the dough more tightly. This has about the same effect as a stretch and fold if you do it right. The telltale signs of a dough with adequate gluten development are that it looks very smooth, holds together, and may even seem a little shiny. If you're using tangzhong in your dough like I do in a lot of my recipes, then you really need to make sure that the dough passes the windowpane test and is well mixed. The process of making tangzhong denatures the proteins in the flour, so any flour you use for tangzhong, you can pretty much assume they won't be contributing to the dough strength. They may even disturb the gluten network and decrease gas retention. This is added to the fact that tangzhong, while not strengthening the gluten structure in any way, actually makes the dough appear drier and stronger, increasing its tenacity. It's an illusion and one that us bakers have to be careful to avoid. There's also one more little note I have to put here, specifically for sourdough. Acidic doughs cause more proteolytic activity from the enzymes in the flour, and what this does is that it literally destroys the gluten chains. Gluten being our glue, if the dough is left for too long like that, it will come apart, becoming a slurry, and you can kiss your dreams of a gorgeous sourdough bread goodbye. So make sure to keep an eye on the sourdough fermentation time. When you shape the dough, you are also building the gluten structure a little bit and forming a taut skin to really hold everything in. That way the rise is upward and in the shape that you want. So making sure to shape the dough properly plays a pretty big part in getting a good ear. Now, when you have both good gas production and gas retention, as well as good shaping, you are mostly guaranteed an aerated loaf of bread, as long as you proof the dough properly. The most common problems with proofing are overproofing and underproofing. Overproofing is when you let the dough ferment for too long and it ends up with too much gas for the gluten network to handle. In extreme overproofing, your dough can expand so much that it collapses before it even goes into the oven. In less severe cases, the dough will come into the oven already very puffy, expand dramatically when exposed to the heat, and then collapse before the bread sets. Underproofing is the opposite, but can look similar. In the worst case of underproofing, you don't have any gas at all. This lack of aeration means non-fluffy bread, and more technically, the heat transfer to the center of the dough will be a lot worse. It's more difficult for heat to reach the center when it's all dense dough rather than airy gas bubbles. All of these contribute to gummy and dense bread. In contrast, mildly underproofed bread can look very normal or even spectacular on the outside, but when you cut open the bread, you could see something like this. A big gaping hole in the bread's otherwise nice crumb. This is because while the gas produced was enough to give the dough an oven spring, the crumb was affected by the lack of proofing and distribution of the gas cells. So while between overproofing and underproofing, I prefer underproofing, it's still best to get the best right amount of proofing. It's like taking the lesser of two evils, but wouldn't it be better to aim for the good choice in the first place? At the end of proofing the dough, we come to our next point for getting a good ear, which is how you score it. There are a million tutorials for this. I'm about to give you the millionth and one. Angle is very important. When a sharp blade drags on the dough, it's likely because of the angle and speed. You want the corner directed down and the sharpest side of the blade facing the dough. Hesitation is the enemy, and if you slow down, it can catch. To prevent this, you can do this little step that I like to do, which is just shadowing the movements. After a few runs of that, you lower the blade to the dough and have to trust your muscle memory. For extra ease, you could oil the blade a little bit, but it's not necessary. Chilled dough is also easier to score because it's less sticky and denser, but that comes with its own territory during baking. To give the dough a better chance of forming an ear, after the initial score, you can go in again at a more horizontal angle to create a flap of dough that will separate and rise when in the oven. But scoring may not be as crucial as the next factor. I've seen some people meticulously score their bread, listing like a masterclass of techniques, and I've also seen bakers that just do a quick slash and get fantastic results anyway. What is absolutely crucial, along with the previous factors, is how you bake the bread, and what we'll specifically talk about here, how you steam it. As this paper shows, as the amount of steam injected into the oven increased, it resulted in a crust with a lighter color, which was backed up by other papers, and the bread also ended up with glossier crust, likely due to the increase in gelatinized starch granules on the surface. The full explanation is that the water vapor from steaming the bread allowed formation of a starch paste that will gelatinize form dextrins and finally caramelize to give both color and gloss. Perhaps more interesting to those of us who like eating artisan breads, the paper also showed that as steam increased, so did the brittleness of the crust. What the paper says exactly is that the increase of the amount of steaming used during baking caused an increase in the failure force. To give some context, the crust was measured with a puncture test. You can probably imagine how that would work, and the failure force is essentially the force needed to puncture the bread's crust. Unsurprisingly, this is correlated with stiffer, more brittle, and rigid crust. So steaming the bread will likely make it crispier and harder. That's a big reason why steaming the bread is so important for hard artisan breads. But what about the ear? Well, the general explanation is that because steam keeps the bread's surface moist for longer, it allows for more expansion, more oven spring, and it should contribute to getting an ear. Well, that is mostly true, actually. I have another paper here, also about steaming the bread in the oven, and as this chart shows, as steaming increased, the specific volume of the bread also increased. This trend only has the first bread as an exception, which is the one that was steamed with only 100 milliliters of steam. This is actually directly related to what we're interested in. Take a look at this quote. For low steaming, the higher volume may be attributed to the rupture of the outer shell, which rapidly forms during baking. This may result in an uncontrolled oven rise and finally in a bigger volume. The paper doesn't make any mentions of ears, but that sounds a lot like what happens when an ear forms. The outer crust sets, causing the bread to split apart, literally ripping open and peeling back. And this is also shown in the pictures the paper showed, comparing high steaming to low steaming. It displayed tears that were formed during low steaming that weren't formed at very high levels of steaming, because at that point, the bread dough had enough moisture to allow the crust to expand, thus leading in a smoother surface without cracks. This is despite the fact that the specific volume of the bread made with the most steam was actually higher than the bread with low steaming. This is something that I've experienced myself when I've added a little too much steam into the oven while baking, and the resulting bread looks like this. The skin is super crispy and glossy, the crumb structure is gorgeous, but there are no cracks anywhere, much less an ear forming, because the surface was so moist that it had no problem expanding to compensate for the additional volume. I'll explain in a little more detail. These cracks form because of internal pressure from inside the dough against the crust, like a chick breaking out from an egg. As the paper mentions, the expansion of the bread during baking is balanced by the resistance of the skin of the loaf, which will become the crust. When we use a low amount of steam for the bread, the outer shell of the dough stiffens very quickly, which blocks the oven rise, so the pressure inside the dough increases and builds until the crust can no longer hold it and splits apart. In the case of this paper, the bread had no cuts on its upper surface, no scores, so it ended up with a mushroom shape and several tears around the bottom. This schematic from the paper illustrates what the experiment found in the difference of pressure levels of the low steaming dough and the high steaming one. You can see that massive increase in pressure for the low steaming loaf happening much earlier and at a higher level than with the high steaming one. In essence, that's probably why you won't get an ear if you have too much steam while baking your bread. So how do we actually put this into practice? The key is balance. We still do want steam. As explained, it helps the dough expand and gives us an incredibly important crispy crust that can improve the bread's overall flavor perception. However, too much steam can cause us to lose out on that beautiful ear, which is fine if you're not going for it, but if you are, then it's something we need to be careful of. Too little steam and the crust will dry out far, far too quickly. Not good for the volume, and it likely reduces the look of the ear as well. From what we've tried ourselves, there are a lot of ways to do this, but aside from owning a steam oven, we found the best ways to be by covering the dough during baking or putting it in a Dutch oven. If you're going the first route, covering the dough with something like a loaf pan, then you don't need to be too concerned about generating a lot of steam. The water inside the bread evaporates during baking, and on average, 10 to 20% of the bread's initial mass is lost due to this. So if you're using a relatively small loaf pan to cover the dough and retain the steam from the bread during baking, then the small volume of the pan will have enough steam for the bread to get a crispy crust and that ear, along with the other desired attributes. If you really want to make sure there's enough steam, you can spray the bread with a little water, just a little bit, and the same logic applies for a Dutch oven. Although, because the Dutch oven is a little larger, you can add in some small ice cubes to get some more steam. If you are not covering your bread and just baking it straight away in the hot oven, then you probably need to generate a relatively sizable amount of steam to get its benefits. Depending on your oven's volumes and specifics, such as if it leaks out the steam, you may need an entire tray of lava rocks or maybe just a small cup of water. To roughly calculate how much steam you need, we're going to take a number mentioned in a previous paper on steam and the bread's crust. It doesn't mention any number as optimal or the best, but the researchers tested up to 400 milliliters of steam injection into the oven during baking, which we'll consider an upper limit for now. And this amount of steam translates to 1.33 liters per meter cubic of the oven's volume. As an example, our oven is 60 liters or 0.06 cubic meters in volume, so we get about 0.0798 liters or 79.8 milliliters of steam needed. That is not a lot of steam, but of course, that being said, we must also account for evaporation from the oven, since we're not using a very well-insulated steam oven, and also typically we remove the water once the bread is done with its oven spring. There's probably no exact number that will work for everyone, but with this estimation, I think that it's easier to find out what the base numbers might be. And that's it for this video. Thanks for watching, and bye!